Welcome, everyone. Last week, we learned why you should get married. Tonight, together with a number of you here, we're going to learn how to get married. So welcome to part two of From Torah to the Horah. What an amazing crowd. Firstly, a big thank you to Arielle's done so much to make this program happen from start to finish, and she's there for all of your questions and emails. You may have noticed we have two fantastic, handsome gentlemen over here, Moshe Shaw and his son Yehuda. They are professional wedding players, and they're available for your service. More about that later on. And they'll be joining us in music and dance later on as the ceremony happens here tonight. So tonight we're going to talk about the chuppah and the day itself, because all of you are getting married, correct? You're all engaged to get married? Yes, Rabbi?
Yes. Yes.
You're all excited to be standing under your chuppahs?
Yes.
Yes. Awesome, right. Keith, I'm doing a wedding. Behave. And what we're going to do this evening is we're going to look through some of the beautiful customs and laws that make a wedding into a wedding. And we have actually pre-selected a bride and groom who will be getting married not too long, a couple of months or so. However, they volunteered for the mock chuppah that we'll be performing here this evening. And this is a class. It's not, I mean, we set it up this way, of course, but this is a class. You can stop with questions or thoughts or ideas. That's what we're here for, okay? So let's begin at the beginning. Before Judaism really began in terms of the legal aspects, in the Jewish year 2448, before the Torah was given to the Jewish people, how did people get married? What was the original way? And that was a question that was answered by the Rambam, Maimonides. And he said something very fascinating. You see, before Mount Sinai, I don't mean the hospital on the Upper East Side, I mean the original Mount Sinai in the Sinai Desert, when the Torah was given to the Jewish people, and Judaism really began with its laws and instructions, people didn't really have a ceremony. A guy and girl just met, and they kind of just moved in together. That sounds actually pretty familiar. And that was pretty much it. And you were considered together and married, and you had to be faithful one to the other. However, once the Jewish people began and the Torah was given, there was a formal way in order to get married and a number of different steps you had to take. And that's what we call the chuppah ceremony. The technical term actually is kiddushin. That's really what a wedding is called. And nisuin, which is the latter part, because really the chuppah is divided up into two parts. Okay, and we're going to do a mock-up of both of them this evening. And the word kiddushin comes from the word kadosh. What does the word kadosh mean? Holy, that's right. What does the word holy mean, though?
Separate.
Who said that? Excellent job. The word kadosh actually means separate, distinct, apart. Because something's going to happen to all of you in the next few months, and some of you even a year or so, that you'll be finding yourself under the chuppah. And that is, you're going to be separate. Hopefully you already are. But you're going to be separate from everyone else. Right now, Ethan, you can marry any woman. Meital, relax. Don't you worry, we got him covered. However, once you stand under that chuppah, even actually before, once the ketubah is signed, really, it's all done. You are holy to your wife, Meital, and she is holy to you, Ethan. Okay? You're separate, distinct. When something is separate and distinct, it becomes kadosh. That's where the land of Israel is kadosh. This week is Yom HaTzimut. That's why Shabbat is kadosh, because it's separate from every other day of the week. That's why the Hebrew language is kadosh, and we'll be using some of that under the chuppah as well. So that feeling, you're all going to feel under the chuppah, besides extreme nerves about a lot of other things, is the feeling of kadusha, holiness, that something special is happening, and it is a very holy environment that you're going to get into. So preparation for that moment and understanding what that means at the time as well is very important. That's why we have classes before, which you're all doing here tonight. Preparing yourself for that moment. First of all, we start with something called a ketubah. And this is a cheap version of what all of you are spending a lot of money on, okay? The ketubah is basically a pretty dry document that is signed before. Actually, some Sephardim sign it under the chuppah itself, but for most of us, we sign it before we get to the chuppah itself. And in it are all the obligations that the groom has towards the bride, and heaven forbid, in the case of divorce as well, this document comes into play. And really, what it says in a nutshell, it's actually Aramaic, it's Hebrew letters, but Aramaic, which was a language used many years ago, still actually is learnt in yeshivas today. In it are all the obligations the groom has towards his wife, to take care of her physically. You ready to do that? Emotionally, Jerry, ready for that? Spiritually, physically, every way, shape, and form. And it's signed at the bottom by two witnesses. And generally speaking, we use witnesses who are knowledgeable in Jewish law, so they understand the implications. Now, the bride and groom do not actually sign the ketubah. It has spaces which are filled out. The spaces are the names of the bride and groom and their fathers and mothers sometimes, and sometimes their last names, depends what the customs are, the location and the date, and you want to get that right. You really, really do. It takes time to do that, okay? That's a crucial part of the wedding itself. And really, once this is signed, it kicks in. In other words, although it's signed before the chuppah itself, this really validates a lot of where you are going in terms of your future marriage and the wedding itself, okay? So you want to have someone fill out who knows what they're doing, obviously, and the people signing it seriously. Now, you have friends of yours who maybe want to sign the ketubah, but maybe they're not so aware of Judaism, you know? And so what you can do, which is what I do, is I have them have an English section. The English section, which is not a translation of this, thank goodness, the English section has inside it basically no halachic, no Jewish legal significance. And I'll sometimes say to people, they can fill out, you know, usually I looked in his eyes and, oh, well, coming together and we love each other and all that, you know, rest of that stuff. That's all great. And then you have people sign it, and it's a nice way to give an honor to other people. Because really what a wedding is all about is honors. Honoring other people. What we call in Hebrew, kibudim. And there's lots of them that you can have. My wedding, I had tons of people, friends, family, and rabbis, people who traveled in from, you know, where I'm from, London, and I wanted to honor them. So I wanted lots of different things. So there's various honors you give to people. As well as that, a wedding is made up of laws and customs. Laws you have to keep. Customs depend on your community, and you can kind of sometimes play with them, whether you do or don't want to do something in terms of the customs that you'll be using, okay? And that's really a major part. This, however, is legal. It's got to be done, filled out correctly, and signed by people who know what they are doing. And obviously the person filling out knows it as well. I've seen many ketubahs over the years filled out by rabbis that are wholly inaccurate, okay? And sometimes mistakes are made. Many times people go to ketubah.com. Really what you're paying for is the art. The inside is pretty much set. The artwork on the outside, really, I was at a wedding once. I didn't perform it. And the bride and groom had a ketubah that wasn't kosher. Whatever it was a messed up ketubah, they couldn't use it. The rabbi took out a napkin and wrote out the entire thing on a napkin and used that. It worked. It wasn't very fancy. I don't know if they hung the napkin on the wall as a memory of their wedding, but it got the job done. That's all you need, no big ideas. Guys are like, we can save money here, right? Why are we spending $600 on our ketubah? Oh yeah. Oh yeah, I mean, I've seen ketubahs $2,000, $3,000, $4,000. It's art, okay? I know, not for the likes of us, okay? My ketubah, my wedding, the rabbi made a certain mistake in it, and he pulled out another one like this. My wife still has not forgiven me, right? For the actually, he didn't make the mistake. It was actually in the ketubah itself. I pretty much got the wrong one. So that's really how you begin. Now, as well as that, you have a civil license. Now, according to a New York law, you have to be a rabbi, a person doing the wedding, has to be verified and has to be registered as a notary, as it were, in order to perform the wedding, okay? And I had that as well. I had to go to the city hall and prove I was a rabbi, show my certificate and all the rest of it, and that allows me to do that. According to American law, a rabbi is not allowed to perform a wedding unless they sign that thing, that document first. So really, you should sign that first before you actually sign the ketubah. okay? And that depends on where you're from. You can get married in New Jersey, it's different to New York. I've done weddings in California, I did a wedding in Dallas, I did a wedding in Florida. They're all different, but pretty much I've either one or two witnesses on that civil license. That's a nice honor to give other people. You have a non-Jewish boss, stick him in the civil license, right? That's where, right, you want to be nice to him, kiss up to him a little bit. That's where you stick him in the civil license, and it's a big, big honor to give people. And you tell them that, we're very honored. If you could sign our civil license, like, wow, right? So that's a wonderful and good thing to do, okay? So the civil license has been signed, and you have the ketubah ceremony. Now, there's a couple of customs right after this. Two ways to do things. One way, in the more religious world, and not always, you have what's called a tish. The tish literally means a table, it's Yiddish, and the bride is waiting outside the tish room, usually in the reception area, and the groom, after the signing of the civil license, they did that already, and the ketubah, is marched out, usually if he's able to, by his father and his future father-in-law, because they're not married yet, to visit the bride. And they do what's called the bedekin or the kabbalat panim. They lift up the veil. That's one way to do it. However, there's actually another way to do it, which probably, technically, is probably the right way to do it. And that is that before the groom escorts his bride under the chuppah, he leaves the chuppah and lifts up her veil. Why is he doing that? Why does he lift up the veil? What's the veil all about? Yeah. Making sure he marries the right woman. Why? Because someone make a mistake and marry the wrong woman? Yes, who did that?
Moses.
Not Moses. He married the right one. Yaakov, that's right. Yaakov married, well, he was actually meant to marry a sister, a young lady whose name was Rachel. And his future father-in-law was a trickster named Lavan. And Lavan did a switcheroo. Switcheroo? Because he said, you know what, you want to marry my daughter, but you got to work for me for 7 years. He was able to do that. And he did a switcheroo. She actually married the older sister. And Rachel acquiesced to that. Acquiesced to that. He ended up marrying two sisters, which, by the way, you're not allowed to do now, according to Jewish law. I'll mention that. It's true, it's true. However, this is before the Torah was given, and it was permitted then. Right? So he married, first of all, he married Leah, the older sister. And then he actually had a twin brother. Esau was meant to actually marry Leah. That was actually his beshert, Leah. Was meant to marry Esau, two older siblings, and then two younger siblings, Jacob was meant to marry Rachel. Esau decided to miss out on his soulmate, not a discussion for tonight, but actually there was a soulmate, and marrying two sisters instead, okay? Beautiful idea, actually. They say that he wanted to marry Rachel. He married Leah first. However, he had to wait 7 years just to get to marry her, 7 years. And they say that he did it Yamim Achadim, one day at a time. He got through that time they were separate and challenged by taking it one day at a time. That's how he got through that experience. He ended up doing it and having children, many children, through both of these sisters, which actually became the Jewish people. The 12 tribes came from that relationship. So that's one reason. One reason is you want to make sure you're marrying the right one. You want to make sure that her father's not doing switcheroo with the older sister. You know what I'm saying? You want to make sure of that, right? You have a sister? You don't, great, you're safe then, fine. Either way, you're going to do it. What other reason do we use the veil and lift up the veil? Or why does a bride even wear a veil? Or what does a veil do? It covers the face. It covers the face. Now, there are different customs. Some people keep the veil on the entire wedding ceremony, right? Lubavitch Hasidim. Actually, she wears a thick veil she can not even see through. Okay, the entire ceremony, I believe. And some people, you should have a light one, some people lift it up before and she doesn't wear it during the chuppah ceremony itself. Well, another reason is because you may think she looks so beautiful, right? Every Jewish bride looks like a princess, right? A queen under her chuppah. The only time you call a Jewish woman a princess and feel good about it, right? She looks beautiful. And you're going to think, you know why he's marrying her? He's marrying her because look how beautiful she is. And so we say, you know what? That's true. She looks great. And every Jewish man even shapes up once in his lifetime, right? And cleans up nicely, puts a nice suit and smells good, and nice shoes and nice pants, and looks fantastic. But you know what? That's just the external. There's an internal. So we kind of cover her face for a few moments, as it were, to say that although she's beautiful, there's something deeper happening here you don't even see. That's the depth behind having the veil as well. When do you get married? So different customs. You can get married pretty much any time, as long as it's not a Jewish holiday, is pretty much the accepted thing, because you can't stick together two smachot, two happy occasions. Does anyone know the best day of the week, which most people don't get married on, I didn't get married on, to get married during the week? Rosh Chodesh is very good. Actually, today is Rosh Chodesh. That's the best time of the month. That's very good. Yes, Rosh Chodesh is a very good time. Getting married Rosh Chodesh?
Yeah.
Well done. Not this Rosh Chodesh, because we're late. Good, okay, fine. Yes. What day of the week? That's very good, though. Thank you. What day of the week? That's the new month, because new month begins. Chodesh is month, but Chadash means new. So you're starting something new. That's very nice. Good choice. What day of the week? Not Thursday. What?
Tuesday.
Do you know why? You just took a guess. You know why? Why? Very good. In Hebrew, the Torah tells us the only day of the week that was described as being good twice, Kitov. Kitov is a Tuesday. So there actually was a tradition, but people used to get married on Tuesdays. I'll tell you something even wilder than this. Ready for this? It used to be very expensive to get married. I mean, it still is. People could not afford it. Do you know what people used to do? They used to get married on, this is religious people as well, get married on Friday afternoon. And so the money they were going to spend on Shabbat for a nice Shabbat dinner, they would double up to be a wedding feast as well. And that will become their wedding feast, because it's a mitzvah to have a feast, to eat and to celebrate, actually on Friday night. That's the way they used to do it. Is that wild? Tuesday night's the best night, but really, besides Jewish holidays and days of mourning as well, you can get married. By the way, a little myth I want to get rid of. Some people think you can't get married if you're in your year of mourning. This is not true. If a person, heaven forbid, it shouldn't happen to any of you, but if a person, chas v'shalom, heaven forbid, loses a father or a mother, they can get married in their first year. People think, I need to push it off. You don't push it off. You don't push it off. And by the way, even during certain periods of Jewish mourning that we have during the year, you can get engaged. Okay? You can get engaged during the 3 weeks, for example. Why? Because you want to make sure no one else is going to take your guy or your girl. So engagements, we even push off everything else, just to make sure that he knows that we are together. Okay? But weddings, certain times, Tuesdays, Rosh Chodesh is a good time. I performed a wedding on Hanukkah. We did the wedding ceremony. I went out and I lit the menorah. Okay? So this is the way people do things. Okay. The dress. So the bride wears a dress. You're aware of that, right? You want to make sure you say yes to the dress, right? Okay. Now, what color is the dress? It wasn't a trick question. What color is the dress? White. Why is it white? Why does a bride wear a white dress? So interesting, most people think it's to show that she actually is a betula, she's a virgin, and that's not true. Because even a woman getting married twice, third or fourth time, interesting, right, is going to wear a white dress. Actually, it's for a different reason, and a very, very important one, which has implications for all of you. And this is great news. When else in the Jewish year do people generally, Jewish holiday cycles, wear white? Yom Kippur. Yom Kippur, the Jewish men will wear a white talit or a kittel, they wear a white thing, like a white lab coat, you know what I'm talking about? Why? Because white is a sign of purity. Purity. You ready for this? Your wedding day is Yom Kippur. All your sins until that point are wiped away. It's a new clean slate. You feel good now, right? Oh, I know I did. That's something to look forward to. All of your sins are wiped away. There's actually a custom for many people to fast the day of their wedding up to the chuppah. They fast, they don't eat or drink. Right, Sephardim don't do it, they'll drink a little bit. Different customs. Either way, you shouldn't indulge yourself too much the day of your wedding. You feel yourself getting sick or fainty, which happened once under a chuppah with me, another story for another time, but you should have something. But that's really the custom. And actually, the Jewish man, when he prays in the morning, he puts his tefillin on. You should do that, by the way. Prayer is a big part of the wedding day for yourselves. You're praying for your future life together. It's like Yom Kippur, you pray. This is your new beginning. Your sins are being, it's a complete new beginning for you. You're considered new creations. You wear white to represent that. He actually will say part of the Yom Kippur service. You know the Al Chait part, where you clap your heart, you bang your heart a little bit? Actually, that small part of the Yom Kippur service, what is it, like 5-10 minutes, is added on to the morning service for the groom himself, right? And the bride as well, if she wants. So this is a very important time for you. So the wedding is fun, and it's going to be awesome, and you're going to dance, and you're going to eat. And the real mitzvah, by the way, for everyone else at your wedding is to dance and make you happy. That's the mitzvah. Not to eat the hairy chicken they're bringing out from the caterer, right? And to eat the chopped liver, right? The real mitzvah of all the attendees is to make you happy. Mesameach chatan v'kala. How do they do that? By complimenting you. Jared, you look so good in that suit. Wow, I never knew you could clean up so well. And oh, you just look so fantastic. What was your name?
Jamie.
Jamie? Fantastic. I mean, you just cleaned up. Mwah! Fat, beautiful. What a bride. Did you marry the most beautiful woman in the entire world? This guy, yeah, forget Mark Zuckerberg, right? This guy, he's gonna make more than that. He's so good. That's the mitzvah, right? You're meant to talk the people up, right? That's really the mitzvah. And you're meant to enjoy that, take that in. All that's happening, but at the same time at your wedding, you're starting something very important. And there's a certain seriousness and contemplation, a little bit, that comes with the day. Now you're gonna be terrified and the whole day is gonna go really quickly, like super speedy. Right? You can be like, it's over in a flash. I can't believe that was like 5 hours, you know? Still, at some time during the day, you take a little bit of time to reflect about what you're about to begin. And that's why the groom had what's called in the old days, shoshvin, which nowadays we call the best man. The best man is not meant to look fantastic and find which bridesmaid he wants to marry, okay? I mean, you can do that afterwards. He's meant to take care of the groom. Right? If you lose something, like I did at my wedding, the ketubah, after it was signed, my groom, Lauren, he had to search high and low and he found it, right? He wants people to leave him alone. He wants to contemplate a little bit. He wants to pray a little bit. He wants to hang out with family. He wants to have private time. He's there to protect you. That's what your best man is for. Not to be like, hey, who's a nice bridesmaid for me to, you know, a date in the future. He's there to protect you, to make a covering around you. That's what he's for, okay? So we have a veil. We have the ketubah, we have the bride and groom, we have family, and we've had people we've given out honors to. So we're going to see the other honors that we have as we go forward. Before the wedding, hopefully, the bride is able to go to the mikveh. Now, the mikveh is a whole talk in and of itself, and usually that's discussed personally between a female teacher and the bride herself, but I'll say just one thing if you don't mind, because we're all adults over here. When it comes to physical intimacy, just like anything in life, things get boring and stale. Chicken is delicious, but chicken every night, every week, 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, it gets a lot, okay? Imagine if I told you there was a secret ingredient that let you feel the same way as you do on your wedding night. Imagine that? That's a big thing. I mean, a few weeks later, not so incredible, but a year later, 5 years later, 15 years later, 20 years later. That's where you're going, please God, right? That's where you want to be. There's an idea of separation, of renewal. And that's really what the mikveh is. It's a place where a woman goes in before she goes into with her husband, before the wedding, hopefully, if it works out in her cycle. But then afterwards, right? Afterwards, there's a chance to renew. There's a little bit of time separation. There's a certain amount of preparation and a certain amount of new connection that is built up, okay? I don't push things on people, but I would implore you to read about this. Wonderful books about it. Wonderful book called Total Immersion. I'll send out the link for it. Waters of Eden by Ari Kaplan. A lot of wonderful books about this beautiful and renewing mitzvah, which isn't just for the woman, it's also for the man, that keeps things fresh. Trust me, I'm married 16 years. It really, really helps to keep a freshness and a newness, which I can't even describe. I know people who don't need it anymore, okay, because they've reached a certain age where a woman doesn't have to immerse in the mikveh, and they see they miss that time of separation and then reconnection. Okay, but that's the guarantee. Freshness and newness. Okay, it's time to get married. Are you all ready? Yes, Rabbi? A little bit of excitement over here. Come on, what's wrong with you all? Okay, so we're going to need a few things. The first thing we need is a chuppah, right? So let's pull a chuppah, which was lent to us very kindly over here. The chuppah bearers, please come forward. I need one more. Anyone want to volunteer to hold the chuppah on the floor for about 10 minutes? Should I pick someone over here? Come on, handsome. Okay, guys. Okay, we have one over here. Yeah, you got that pole? And you're gonna hold this one over here. And this one is over here. One second. Hold that one over there. And okay, you're going to come over here, I think. Switch positions with the chair over there. That's it. Okay, is that right? And pull it out and stretch it out, stretch it out, stretch it out. Okay, stretch it out. You good, good? Oh, you're good. Put it on the floor. You comfortable? If you get faint, just let me know. This is a chuppah. What is it? Why do we make such a big deal out of it? Trees and canopies and talits. I mean, I've been under nearly 100 chuppahs myself. I mean, I've only married once, but performing weddings, I mean. And people use heirlooms and blankets and talit from grandparents. I got married. It was a very emotional wedding where the bride had a talit that belonged to her grandfather who was a Holocaust survivor. Can you imagine that? That's a very, very beautiful and powerful gesture. But what is it all about? You comfortable? You good? You good? You good? Fine. What's it about? What do we do under the chuppah? Why do we have a chuppah? Represents a what? A house. Does this look like a house to you? Does this look like a house?
Yes.
No, really? A house looks like this? I hope not. If this is what he's planning and buying you for a house, you're not doing well. But you're absolutely right. It is. It is a house. Which house? Which house is open on all four sides? The house of Abraham and Sarah, Avraham and Sarah Imenu, the first ever Jews. Why was the house open on all four sides, ladies and gentlemen? Why do they do this? Why couldn't they have a normal house? Because they lived in a tent. They were very wealthy. They could have actually had a house if they wanted to, made of brick and stone, but they chose a tent, and they opened it on all four sides. And when my kids, around this time of year, when the Torah portions discuss this, they'll come home with a little plate upside down with four doors cut out of it. You know, you're at that time of year in the book of Genesis when the kids come home with that project. And the answer is because they wanted to welcome guests into their home. They created a home built upon giving. So they wanted people to come in from all four sides. And they wanted blessing to come into the home from all four sides as well. And that's where you're starting. So you're going to stand under a chuppah. You actually need a chuppah. Any canopy that's going to cover you is sufficient, and that's what it represents. Because you're starting a brand new family, yes? Yes, and it represents the house that you and your fiancé or your husband are going to build together, absolutely. But it's modeled into this fashion as a remembrance of the first house of Abraham and Sarah, all four sides. We want blessing coming in. That's what you want, a lot of blessing. And it's going to be a lot of blessings under the chuppah as well. The word in Hebrew for a blessing is a bracha. The word bracha is a very interesting word. It comes from the word brecha, Israeli metal. What's a brecha? A pool of water, right? Originally, it actually meant a force of water coming up. Just like water flows, so too you want the blessings to flow as well. And this is the time to catch those blessings. This is the time. Actually, the word mazal tov does not mean good luck. The word mazal is related to another word which means nizul, which means to flow. When someone says mazal tov to you, they're not saying, good luck with that. I know this guy, right? Good luck with her. That's very offensive. It doesn't mean good luck. There's no luck in Judaism. None of that at all. There is mazal. And mazal means I want things to flow well. It also means the constellation astronomically as well. Right? Astrologically, rather. Things should align, the stars should align for you. It means that as well. We want to be married at the right time, in the right way, to the right person. But it means mazal, things should flow well for you. You want the blessings to come into your home. Trust me, it starts on the wedding day. Many women have the custom, it's a beautiful custom, and I recommend even a few moments. Under the chuppah, you're looking good and smiling with the rest of it. But many Jewish women, you'll see, will actually have a piece of paper, and they'll be praying and staying with a piece of paper. Have you seen this before? Count for this. More religious weddings, but anyone can do this. And they have names of people they want to pray for, specifically women and girls they know who are single. Okay, it's called an et ratzon, a time of great potential. Your prayers are listened to because it's a new beginning for you. You all have single friends? Yes, Rabbi. You have single siblings? Anyone who want to get married? It's a very opportune time to pray for them under the chuppah. So my wife stood under there. She had a whole list, like a whole Megillah. Right? She didn't focus at all. I'm like, what about me? She's like, and then she was praying the whole thing, a beautiful thing. Happens to be, you can ask my wife this, everyone she prayed for, thank God, ended up getting married. Okay, in a fairly short amount of time right afterwards. Some of them who, by the way, incredibly got married, you would never have thought it at all. Okay, let's begin our ceremony. And we have a bride and groom who will be getting married, but only for fake and pretend tonight. Alana and Brandon are going to be our bride and groom. Thank you so much. Ez a mazal. Ez a mazal. Now you know where you brought your talit, okay? So she's gonna, okay, fine. She's put a veil on that we gave her as well. Guys, stand up, please. Could you get a yarmulke and stick it on this guy's head, please? Thank you so much. Okay, any questions, by the way? This is a Q&A, anytime. Anything we said so far? Okay, awesome. We're gonna ask our resident Chuppah players, the Rabbi Moshe and Yehuda Shore Band, to play for us as our bride and groom. Enter, first of all, the groom enters. Slow, enjoy it. Usually he has his parents, hands out your pocket. His parents escorting him, and he walks out, that's right. And sometimes they'll have candles, a sign of light and newness, and he's first under the chuppah. Then we have usually the bridesmaids will come down, and the family, and the whole shebang will schlep down as well, and that's very beautiful. And finally, the queen comes, and that is our bride. And she is a queen, by the way, and he is the king. I mean, very simple, the entire week after their wedding, they have a special status in Judaism, and she marches down with her veil, don't bump into anything, and she's got a mother and father.
Baruch haba miyadir al hakol.
Stop it there. And the groom leaves the chuppah, because we're going to follow the other custom, and he lifts up the veil. Is that her? Good stuff, okay. Okay, usually thanks her parents, who are delighted to get rid of her finally. And then he's going to escort her. So he brings her under the chuppah, and they enter together, but he's bringing her in. Just like on Mount Sinai, God was waiting for us as the Jewish people arrived, so too. Then we have a custom for the bride to walk around the groom 7 times. Okay? Yes, and he goes anti-clockwise. That way, that's right. Seven represents 7 days of the week. Okay? It represents the 7 times the priest walked around Jericho to bring down the walls. And that's what she's doing. She's creating walls around him to protect him from the outside negative forces, and also building walls around him as well. It's a beautiful custom. Not everyone does it, but those that do. How many times is that? We always lose count, by the way. Don't worry if you lose count. Okay? You can do it. 6? Very good. With a wedding dress, you don't go this fast, by the way. One more time. And you're getting up to his right. You're his right-hand woman. That's very nice. Thank you.
Thank you, Dad.
Okay, very good. So now we have our bride and groom under the chuppah, and the rabbi is there as well. So we begin with... Thank you. You guys okay? Yeah? Don't faint on me, boys. I don't have any of that mess. We start with blessings. And the first blessing is made over the wine by the Masada Kedushin. And this is actually the person doing the wedding. And we use wine, specifically white wine. Why do we use wine under a chuppah? We use wine because wine tastes good. And you'll notice that whenever wine is used, something is changing. You're going from the day to Shabbat. You're changing. You're going from a regular day to a Jewish holiday. A baby that's Brit Milah gets wine because he's going from non-Jewish to Jewish, although he's Jewish, but there's a transformation there as well. Whenever wine is used, things are changing. And wine is good for that because it also changed. This was once like a little bunch of grapes sitting on a vine somewhere, Israel, California, wherever, and they took it and they crushed it and they squeezed it, and out came this delicious thing. We want the same for you. There's going to be a little bit of crushing happening in every single wedding and marriage. But white wine is going to come out of that. Or wine is. Why white wine? Because it doesn't stain if it spills on our dress. Usually we use red wine, we use white. And my favorite joke, what is a Jewish woman's favorite wine? I want to go to Miami. That's That's a great joke, that. I don't tell under the chuppah. I tell other jokes, but not that one. Because there's always some grandmother from Miami that managed to, like, you know, shake out and schlep up. Okay, so we make the blessings. So I'm going to make the blessings for educational purposes. The first blessing is Brei Pri HaGefen, as in Pesach HaKadoshim. Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam, Borei Pri HaGefen.
Amen.
You're just not drunk at this point, but since I made the blessing. Okay. The second blessing, I'll just say it in English. Blessed are you, Hashem, our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with his commandments, commanded us regarding forbidden unions, gave us betrothed women and gave us the ability to marry, and permitted women who married us through the canopy and through consecration, chuppah, and kiddushin. Blessed are you, Hashem, who sanctifies, mekadesh, makes holy, his people, Israel, through canopy, chuppah, the kiddushin. And that's this part of the ceremony. At this point, everyone will say amen at the end of that blessing. The groom will take a sip. And then usually, you drink wine, yeah?
It is wine, wow.
Yeah, it is wine. Water. No, it's wine. And I can't take water to wine. I can buy wine. And then usually the bride of the mother will come forward and usually give a little sip to the bride herself. Okay, you'll take your hello. I don't want someone like, yeah. Okay, you'd be looking forward to that, right? A little sip. Okay, so that's happened and both blessings are made. At this point, we use a ring. We use a ring. And we've got a ring we can use over here. I'll take a plain band if anyone has one. Okay, I'll take that one, fine. Okay, thank you so much. Okay, fine. So this is the engagement ring. This could not be used under the chuppah. Oh, by the way, side point, many people have the custom not to wear any jewelry at all under the chuppah. You heard this before, anybody? It's such a custom to wear any jewelry at all. You want to act pure, and he's marrying her just for who she is and not because of her adornments and jewelry. Other people have a custom not to have any ties or knots, okay, on them at all, okay? So they'll, for example, a Jewish man will untie his shoelaces, whatever, and just tuck them in, because the only tie and bond that's going to happen is between the bride and groom. These are all customs that happen. However, this would not work. Why would this ring not work under a chuppah? A couple of things. One, it belongs to her. Two, there's a big diamond on it. There's a big diamond on it. What should this ring be? A plain band. A plain band. Okay? It can have a little engraving, like a hallmark or something. That's okay. But it shouldn't have any diamonds on it. Why not? Because the groom has to know, and the bride has to know exactly kind of like what it's worth. And stones are, you know, we're not too sure what their worth could be. It could be a real beautiful 5-carat diamond like this. Don't tell me it's less, I won't believe it. Or it could be cubic zirconia, which is not, I hope, right? So we don't even know. So we take an unadorned ring, and it must belong to the groom. The groom must have acquired it, he must know it's his. Then there are two witnesses that are called up. They could be the same guys that signed the ketubah in the Hebrew section. Or, if you have more people to honor like I did, you'll find two other guys that come forward who are very knowledgeable, right? Try and make to be as observant Jews. They come forward, they look at it, they make sure it's worth more than a prutah, more than a few dollars. And then he will take the ring in his right hand, and she'll lift up her right finger up into the sky, and you're not going to do it.
Not today.
Because if you did it, and you said the magic words, you could actually be married. I'm not kidding. And there's famous stories of young kids playing around, right? Giving things to each other and saying the magic words, which are all the guys are going to say. Hari ha-mekadeshet li b'tabat zukadat mosh Yisrael. Behold, you are betrothed to me according to the law of Moses with this ring. And she accepts it, or even a bag of chips or something. You're married, which is a problem, because you need to get divorced. And there's stories of young guys and girls who act it out a little bit, do it, put the ring, and therefore, not today, bub. Not today, okay? So you're going to take that. He'll put that into her finger. It goes on her right forefinger. According to our tradition, the right forefinger is connected to the heart. And then afterwards, you can change another finger. Do not try to jam it down. It's not going to fit. Your pointer finger is too big. It'll just lay on where the knuckle is above it. And then at the end of the ceremony, you'll move it to another finger. Okay? After that, you do whatever you could throw in the river. Right? Whatever you want to do with it. Don't do that, right? But that would work as well. Okay? So now the ring's on the finger. The witnesses watched it. They are actually really married at this point. Then there is a custom to make a separation between the first part of the ceremony and the second part of the ceremony. Any questions, by the way? Please, don't be shy. Please, please, please. You're good? Yes.
So,
from the bride.
Yes, from the beginning.
Don't do this under the real wedding,
no,
okay?
No.
Knowing you, Alana. I'm doing her wedding. I don't want to be doing this. Yes.
At the bedeckin?
Yes.
Do I have the veil on already, or does he?
No. So different customs. Usually you don't, and you have it down. When you march down, then he'll come and usually uncover you at that point. Yeah, at the bedekin. That's usually does it. He sees it's you and then puts it down. Some people will wear under the chuppah, as I said, some people won't. Ethan, no veil for you. I know you want to wear one, but you're too good looking.
Thank you. Under the chuppah, does she wear her engagement?
So that's a matter of custom. That's a matter of custom. Some do, some don't. That's the honest truth. Okay? Again, these are just customs. Okay? According to Jewish law, it's not a problem. Okay? Now, here there is a difference between denominations in Judaism. According to Rav Moshe Feinstein, a very big rabbi who lived here in New York, actually, he died in the 80s, I think. According to him, the groom has to give a ring to the bride as a gift. She can't put one on his finger at the same time, because then it's not a gift, it's an exchange. Okay, so it's technically not the right thing to do. Now, your rabbis may say differently. You've got to speak to whoever your particular rabbi is. But ideally, you should not be putting a ring. If you want to put one at the end of the ceremony, afterwards, by the way, no one even sees it. I wouldn't worry about it. I always tell couples, no one even sees it anyway. They don't know. They don't notice the stuff. Okay? You want to do that. Vows. Some people do vows. I'm not so into it because she gets all like verbose. Oh, I've waited for this moment my entire life. And the mascara comes down and the snot bubble. You know, and she gets all emotional. And your average Jewish male, his sister is like, me too, you know? So I'm not into it. However, you should give, not you two, you're lovely, but usually at the ceremony afterwards, by the meal, get up, thank your parents for coughing up all this money, and you know, and that's a good time to do it. I'm not into it, it's not a Jewish custom to make vows. Your job is to stand there and look good, which you're doing beautifully, by the way.
Thank you.
Isn't it a beautiful couple, by the way? You should get married. Oh, you are getting married, okay, fine. Oh, enough of that, take it easy. Okay, then we read the ketubah. Okay, which is usually read by the rabbi, but if there's someone else, it's another honor you can give to another visiting rabbi. Okay, someone else to read it. It's in Aramaic. Find someone who reads well, or they'll be doing it for 25 minutes. Okay, this is not a time to find Uncle Ari from Tel Aviv to come forward and come on, you read Hebrew. They can't read this stuff. And I'll be there forever. Be'echad b'shabbat. You don't want to do it without. You know what I'm saying? You want to sort of go right through it and get it done. And that is the custom. After that happens, right, so he's been signed, he then takes it with both his hands, okay, and it's a good photo opportunity. Look at the camera. Okay, and then he gives it to her. Okay, look at it, look at it. No, okay, fine, look at the camera. Yeah, there you go. Beautiful. This now belongs to you. Usually she'll give it to her mother, then put it away somewhere, but it must be with you the rest of your life. According to Jewish law, you lose this, you can't live together. It's got to be with you in your home wherever you are, or you have to know where it is. At least you have to know where it is. Kind of like, oh, I left it in the old house, as I heard from someone, okay? This is very, very important. Lose it, and it is trouble, okay? So you want to make sure that it is always contained. Some people do hang it up on the wall, but okay, fine. If you want to do that, you can do that, but it's like sticking a mortgage license on the wall, you know what I'm saying? But you spend a lot of money on the ark, ketubah.com got a lot of your cash, so you can go ahead with that, okay? Fantastic. We finished that. Yes, question?
I've heard that, like, family members, let's say cousins, like, could they sign?
No, ideally they should not. If you want them to, go to the English section. Family members are not kosher eidim, not considered to be okay to as witnesses. But we're going to have something else for them to do. Okay, the English section is not a problem. English section has no halachic significance. Hebrew section only. I sometimes have the bride and groom make four witnesses in the English section just to, like, just stuff people in there. I've been to a Persian wedding. They signed right around. They were like, everyone came forward, right? They signed around the, I was like, further out, push it out there. You know, not too close to the main thing itself.
Two signatures on the Hebrew section.
Two second Hebrew section, English section, as many as you can fit in. Yeah. On the right-hand side. Now, some people have the bride and groom face out. I like to do it because I want people to see their faces. Some have the custom where the bride and groom face in, but she's always going to be to his right. The right is the right. That's why the right also for the ring is because it represents chesed, kindness. Right? According to Kabbalah, the left is considered gevurah, strength. So it goes on the right with the right hand to the right hand. Oh, and when the groom goes out of the chuppah and the bride, right foot first. Always right, always takes precedence, going to Kabbalah over the left. Right, that your body is split into two. Right side is kindness, left side is strength. Okay, so we always do things with the right hand when we do mitzvot. Are we good? Okay. There is another custom that Sephardim have. What are you going to do? How are you going to daven tomorrow? You have plenty. Okay, you sure? Okay. Thank you very, very much, Rabbi Blachman, for the use of your talit. Mazel tov. Yeah. Okay, this is the talit. This is bought, usually by the bride's side. Don't get one of these little scarfy things you wore at your bar mitzvah, or in some of your cases, bat mitzvah. Get a proper big gezunta talit like this, okay? It's going to wrap around the entire shoulders. Why do we use a talit? So actually, you should use a new talit, or new to you at least, but it should be new talit, so you can make a blessing of a shechianu, v'kimanu, v'giyanu. That's the most beautiful blessing. We make it a few times through the year and under the chuppah, hopefully. Sephardim do it, but now I see more and more people do it as well. German Jews do it as well. The Yekis as well, right? They also wear a talit. And the reason is you can make a blessing. You can't make a blessing of gratitude to God over a person, but you can make it over a new item. That's really what it's going to do. And he'll make the Shechianu blessing on it. The groom will take it. He will make the blessing. Baruch atah Hashem. Elokeinu melech olam, shechianu, v'kimanu, v'higianu, lazman hazeh. Beautiful. He'd wrap it around. And many people have the custom to wrap it around the bride and the groom. So you're going to grab it on the right-hand side. They wrap themselves. This is, they're wrapped together in the talit, right? Very, very beautiful. If she starts getting hot and sweaty and she's going to faint, take it off, okay? So we'll do that. Like this. And at this point, you feel okay? You're good? You're good. And you can smile. You're getting married. And then we have the sheva brachot, the seven blessings, okay? Did we do everything? Yeah, we did the ketubah, we did the ring, a lot going on, right? I did a wedding once. Once, one of the early weddings I did of a young lady, and she met her husband at one of my trips, and I had a premonition, the only time it ever happened, that she was going to faint under the chuppah. I don't know why I had a premonition. It never happened since. I've performed tons of weddings. And I was very nervous first. I remember the third or fourth wedding I was doing. You're very busy, you know, now. But then I was like, what's going to happen? I mean, people, you know, talk to the parents, coming up to you, don't make it too long. This is my Aunt Mildred from Canada, you know, there's all this kind of stuff. Anyway, so I was there, and I kind of pushed it out of my head. And she came under the chuppah of the bride, and she looked okay. I said, you okay? She said, fine. So I pushed it out of my head because I was very busy. Then her mother came, and the wedding's going well. I think, oh, fantastic. I hear from behind me, oi, turn around, her mother, whoop, caught by the husband, right, grabs hold of her, and I'm standing there, and literally there's a fainted mother-in-law, and I thought to myself, I knew it, okay? So he sits her down in a chair, right, he's like slapping her in the face around her husband, right, trying to get her out of the stupor. I'm like, this is not happening. I was like, is there a doctor in the audience? Not a single doctor. 500 lawyers, not one doctor. Someone said, I can help. I said, what are you? She goes, I'm a dental nurse. I'm like, the teeth are okay. Anyway, they revived her. It's because she didn't drink it. She was very, very flustered. She drank alcohol, by the way, which is not a good thing to do for her. Right? Anyway, she came around. I said to the bride, should we carry? She's like, get on with it. Okay, anyway, they're married, fine. So make sure you're well hydrated. Okay, fine. There are seven blessings that you make. The first one is Berei Pri HaGefen. And these seven blessings can be given to even family members. Okay, if you have someone who schlepped in from Israel, you got a family coming in from Israel or something, so you want to give that to a father or an uncle, right? These are nice honors to give people. The first ones are short, the second grouping a little bit longer, the last one is very long. Okay, give that to someone who knows how to hopefully sing or at least read Hebrew well. Okay, otherwise you're going to be there forever, right? And you got to get out. By the way, this whole thing shouldn't take more than 25 minutes, unless you have a chazan. No offense, you've had another 20 minutes to the whole ceremony, okay? I'm just telling you, they add time. But people like that. People like that, okay? The blessings are very, very beautiful. It's worth looking at them. Bless you, Hashem, the universe, who has given us the fruit of the vine, the Berei Pri HaGefen, who has created everything for his glory, who has fashioned mankind. It's really a history of the world that has led from the Garden of Eden right to this point. And the last one is the most beautiful, who has created joy and gladness, groom and bride, mirth, glad song, pleasure, delight, love, brotherhood, peace, companionship. Lovely, lovely words. And it's really a blessing of enjoyment. And everyone who's there should answer Amen at the end. So make sure your rabbi tells them, right? Because they're, by them saying Amen, they are adding to the blessings coming through. Then it finishes. At which point, the groom drinks a little bit more. Sip. Rashi drinks a little bit more as well. Usually her mother-in-law, his mother at this point, if you're able to have that, gives her a little sip at the end, because she's now your mother. Right? Oh, that's nice for some people. That'll be next week's discussion. And after that, we have, sometimes, we'll choose a little song about... This is a song about Jerusalem. Because although we're very, very happy, we remember the world is not perfect, there is still war, and the temple is not rebuilt in Jerusalem. So we're going to do a couple of things. Some people have this song sung, many people. If I forget you, this is the words of King David. If I forget you, Jerusalem, may my right hand forget its cunning. May my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. Okay, it carries on like that. We're going to stop over there, though. Thank you so much. That was beautiful, though. You guys are good. At this point, we take a glass, or today, a plastic cup, and it is broken under the chuppah with the right foot. And this, obviously, is to remember and to remind us that the world is not perfect. We take a little edge of the joy for just a moment to remember the seriousness that the world is not perfect, but you guys getting married has made the world a little bit better, right? You've built a new creation that starts at your wedding, and this remembers that act. So that usually smash with the right foot, after which everyone screams, Mazel Tov. So that's what we're gonna do. Brandon's gonna smash us with his right foot. You're gonna scream Mazel Tov. We're gonna take this chuppah, we're gonna put it to the side. Then very, very quickly, everyone is going to get off their chairs, stack them, and just move them to the side, stack them, move them to the side, and we're going to have a little Horah dance. Girls over here, and guys over here. Are you ready for this? Everyone knows what's going to happen? Break, Mazel Tov, move the chairs quick to the side, and a little Horah dance with the pleasure of Moshe and Yehuda Shor, who will be playing for us. Hit it. Right foot. Mazel Tov! Hey, you're not really married.
Simen, simen tov,
ay, ay, ay,
mazel, mazel tov. Yehei lanu, chol Yisroel,
keep going, keep going, keep going.
Ay, 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 simen,
simen. Mazel, mazel tov.
Chair, chair. Yay, that's it, get into it. You begin your new life together, you celebrate. You won't get to eat too much, and don't drink too much. But you celebrate with your families and friends. The dancing should be joyous and raucous. And next week, we'll talk about your married life together. Mazel Tov! Very nice, good dancing, good dancing.